The latest that's coming in from Jammu and Kashmir, and it's very, very disturbing. This was a 78-vehicle convoy that was moving from Jammu to Srinagar. There were more than 2,500 CRPF personnel who were shifting from Jammu to Srinagar when a suspected suicide bomber, apparently a suspected suicide bomber, was in a Scorpio vehicle. That's the face of that man. Lots of explosives, by some accounts, more than 100 kgs of explosives stuffed in a vehicle, stuffed in a sports utility vehicle, suspected to be a Scorpio. It rammed into a bus. 30 personnel have been killed. There are 18 who are still critical. That's what we are being told, and this took place on the busy Jammu-Srinagar highway near Avantipora in South Kashmir. The Director General of Jammu and Kashmir Police, Dilbagh Singh, confirmed that this was a suicide attack. He said prima facie, that's what he told me a short while back. He said prima facie, it appears to be a suicide attack. The IEDs were planted in a vehicle which was moving close to the CRPF vehicle on the national highway. Terrorists who were hiding in this area, there are some conflicting reports that seem to indicate that there was some firing that also took place. As of now, this entire area has been cordoned off. The vehicles who were standing by in this area have finally been permitted to now move to their destination. 78 vehicles were there. The CRPF vehicle was completely destroyed. Also, the terrorist vehicle that was completely destroyed. Mangled remains, there you see there. And these are CRPF personnel. There you see shrapnel marks on another vehicle in the vicinity. And I quickly want to cut across to India Today's news director, Rahul Kaval. Rahul, this is one of the worst terror attacks, and the Prime Minister says that these sacrifices will not go in vain.
CRPF convoy, which was coming from Jammu and going towards Srinagar, was attacked. We have suffered damage to the vehicle as well as to the men. We suspect that it was a vehicle-bound attack.
So was it a car?
However, no, it's not confirmed as yet. It's a matter of investigation. All this is a matter of investigation. The Jammu and Kashmir police has taken up the investigation. And we have suffered damage to both men and our vehicles.
It's a terror incident. It's a terror incident, and we are looking into to the possibility of what led to this blast. There was a vehicle convoy which was coming, and it was there is an explosion. And what is the nature of explosion, how it has happened, what led to this explosion, these are all subject of investigation.
Okay.
So we are going to carry out a professional post-blast investigation to understand the circumstances. And at present, what IGCRPF said, that the number of casualties, the injured, whosoever injured, they have been shifted to the hospital.
Okay.
We are now clearing the site.
Okay.
As and when we get the confirmation of the numbers, we will definitely share it.
Is this now an act of war? 30 CRPF personnel killed. Jaish-e-Mohammed, the Pakistan-based terrorist organization, has taken responsibility for this. Joining me now on the broadcast is Lieutenant General Sanjay Kulkarni, Major General Yogi Behel, and Brigadier Mahalingam, three veterans who've served extensively in Jammu and Kashmir. But I first want to cut across to India Today's Ashraf Wani, joining us live from Srinagar. Ashraf, what's the latest as far as these investigations are concerned? What more can you tell us about the suspected suicide bomber?
Gaurav, basically, first of all, this is the
one of the major, we can say the biggest attack so far in the history of Jammu and Kashmir for last 30 years, because we have not seen this amount of casualties in any kind of terror attack, and now which has mounted to 30. Number two is that was there any kind of lapse in the security? That can't be digested, because basically this is a kind of attack which we have earlier seen in the Syria, in the Iraq and in the Afghanistan frequently by the Taliban. That kind of attack was carried out by the Jaish on Jammu Srinagar National Highway, in which specifically this convoy, which was heading after a week from Jammu to Srinagar, as the road was closed due to snowfall and the landslides, and that is why this was the quantum of this convoy was so huge and big. Almost 2,500 security personnel, particularly CRPF men, traveling in this convoy with other logistics. And now the police and the other security agencies are working that from how this attack was managed, from where this car was taken, which is the car. Their first investigation will be from where this car was brought, which was SUV, and then where it was loaded with the explosive, and when, how, what was the track used for to bring this car in this on this highway. And also the most important is that there was also firing after the blast. Yes. On the highway, who were the people who have fired towards the convoy in the open field on Jammu Srinagar Highway.
Ashraf,
these are
stay
the
with me.
Things on which the students. Yes. Are working.
Ashraf, stay with me. And General Sanjay Kulkarni, when terrorist strike, Pakistan-based terrorist strike, and they hit 30 personnel of the CRPF, what should India's response be?
Strike hard and strike fast. Until and unless we teach them a lesson from wherever it has originated, they must pay for this sins. I think every Indian is on board to say strike, and just strike at a place where it hurts them the most, where it really makes them feel that they will never again do such dastardly things. Because it's very, very important that you must convey, and convey it fast. I think the surgical strike immediately after Uri gave a clear signal that don't mess around.
Okay.
And I think it's time now to convey to all these perpetrators that do not mess around. India will react and act as hard as it can. And
but there are also elements within Brigadier Mahalingam, elements who need to be dealt with. Now, this terrorist, this radicalized... Okay, let's quickly cut across and listen in to Hansraj Ahir, Minister of State for Home.
इस तरीके का डरपोक हमला किया गया है और इस आईडी ब्लास्ट में हमारे जवानों को जो शहादत मिली है ये देश का हर नागरिक इसको भूलेगा नहीं. देश के लिए उन्होंने अपना बलिदान दिया है, लेकिन इतना कहकर भी हम सरकार खामोश बैठने वाली नहीं है. ये बहुत दुखद है, हम लोगों को चैलेंज के रूप में हम इसको देखते हैं और इस घटना का हिसाब चुकता होगा. और ना ही हमारी इन आतंकियों के खिलाफ की हरकतें जो करते हैं आतंकी, उसके खिलाफ की कार्रवाई रुकेगी नहीं. और भी जवान अपना हौसला बुलंद करके अपने साथियों की इस शहादत का बदला भी लेंगे और इस आतंकियों को समाप्त करने का जो हमारा निर्धार है उस पर हम डटे रहेंगे. सरकार ने, प्रधानमंत्री जी ने हर हमेशा जवानों को अपडेट करने की कोशिश की है, नए नए इक्विपमेंट देने की भी कोशिश की है. कहीं ना कहीं भी इंटेलिजेंस की बातें आती हैं और इस तरीके से डरपोक आतंकियों ने एक प्लानिंग के साथ में इस घटना को अंजाम दिया है. और ये हम मानते हैं कि हमारे बहुत वीर जवानों को शहादत बलिदान देना पड़ा है. ये दुखद है, इसकी निंदा भी हम करते हैं, लेकिन चैलेंज के रूप में इसको देखा भी जाएगा.
CRPF personnel have been killed in this terror attack. Several are injured. Sadly, several are critical. There was a vehicle laden with explosives. It rammed into a CRPF vehicle. And Brigadier Mahalingam, whoever indoctrinated that local Kashmiri boy, if in case that Adil Ahmed Dar, that is what Jaish-e-Mohammed says, that a local Kashmiri lad was the terrorist, was the suicide bomber. Whoever radicalized him, whoever put explosives in that vehicle, whoever turned that vehicle into a bomb, those elements are still in Kashmir. They need to be hunted down and they need to be dealt with according to the law of the land as quickly as possible.
Absolutely. See, the point we must understand, for example, you have the Jaish-e-Mohammed elements which form the logistic chain of the terror groups there. When the terrorists from across the border come into India, it is these elements who receive them, who house them, and thereafter give them the guides, give them all sorts of support, including finances. That must be clearly understood. Unfortunately, we have not done anything in this respect. These elements, if you may understand, is okay, controlled by these separatists. For example, Hizbul Mujahideen elements were controlled by Gilani. Okay. So therefore, what is required? India, for some godforsaken reason, has not been acting on them and not been acting firmly on them.
General Behel, you agree that enabling ecosystem of terrorists, that enabling system needs to be taken down, because killing a terrorist, 250 terrorists were killed last year. Brilliant job done. But that was only pruning the branches of the terror tree. The roots have to be taken down.
Yeah, absolutely, you are correct that we have to freeze all the sources that are giving them the life. The lifeline has to be broken, and that can be only broken, as suggested by Brigadier Mahalingam, that all these Hurriyat organizations, the supporting organizations, must be frozen. They must be, all facilities given to them must be withdrawn, and they should be taken out there. Beside that, it is also required that we have to change our strategy as regard operating in South Kashmir is concerned, because South Kashmir is dominated by most of the politicians who are part of the PDP government, or okay, who are part of the PDP government, and they are the one who are giving them extreme support. So therefore, when we go out for any operation, everybody who is supporting the militants must be treated as a militant only, whether they are stone pelters or they are a public, normal public.
But this is said, which is not being done. Each time there's a terror attack, General K.K. Sinha, and unfortunately, weeks later it is forgiven, it is forgotten, and then it is said that these are misguided youth. And as one of our guests was pointing out earlier, that one of these elements could be a stone pelter today. Today he has a stone in his hand, tomorrow, God forbid, he may well have a gun in his hand.
Gaurab, you have said it. In my judgment, we are absolutely flawed policies on which we are working. It's absolutely flawed strategy, both at operation and strategic level. Tactically, we are doing things. You have given a figure of 250. These are done on a tactical level. Mind you, nowhere in the world people fight, you know, a hybrid war like this. Nowhere.
Yes.
See, we have to understand, it's not a proxy war. It is a hybrid war, and you have seen. And I'm telling you, the casualty will cross more than 40. You take it
from
me.
God forbid. God forbid.
You take it from me, you know, it is much more. I will come down to the main. What will happen? We'll say we will teach the lesson to Pakistan. Teaching a lesson is not the solution. You have to defeat the Pakistan in the design, in the battle which he has unleashed.
That mind every space. Time, no, yes. one of the biggest problems, gentlemen, is rising radicalization. When Islamic State flags are waved outside the Jamia Mosque in Srinagar, General Kulkarni, when Islamic State flags are waved perhaps even once at the pulpit, when a police officer is lynched in downtown Srinagar, we know that the situation is very bad. But unfortunately, do we have an ostrich-like attitude that we bury our head in sand? We don't know there is a problem. We don't know the solution, or we don't want to fight it.
No, we have to tackle it on a multi-pronged strategy. What they call it, Sam, Dam, Dand, Bhed. Right from governance, which has to improve, which has improved of late since the president's rule. There is no denying the fact. We have to de-radicalize the clergy. We have to de-radicalize the youth. We have to be ruthless, absolutely ruthless, when it comes to stone pelters, soft separatists, terrorists. Without fail, we must get after them. We must see to it that Pakistan, which is considered the root cause, must be tackled. So it has to be a multi-pronged strategy. To say that only we have to do only one by only killing terrorists, nothing will happen. Killing terrorists is one part of that entire strategy.
Yes.
So the whole thing has to be a multifaceted approach, and you will find that, let me tell you, having operated there, I have no doubt that there are at least 50 to 60% people are fence sitters. Moment they find good governance, moment they find that things are not going the way the militants want it, they will only switch over. So about 60% are fence sitters. Not more than 10% are those who are actually involved in it. And
India Today, India Today has the biggest team of reporters on ground already. We have Kamaljeet Kaur Sandhu getting us information from the Ministry of Home Affairs. We have Shujaul Haq Thakur and Ashravani joining us from Srinagar, from Ground Zero. And we'll continue to go to our reporters to get you the latest. And Ashraf, if you are with me, Ashraf, at this point of time, you know, General Sinha, vehicles that were stranded there, they've finally been permitted to go. But the problem persists, and the problem is massive. De-radicalizing these elements who may want to pick up the stone, want to pick up the gun, or now an explosive-laden vehicle for whatever cause. One of the terrorists said that they want to establish an Islamic caliphate across Kashmir.
Gaurav, what you are saying, you know, that is what the root problem is. The problem is that, you know, they want to do it something on ISIS model. They want, and they have, you know, to fairly large extent, they have succeeded. See, when we are talking about radicalization of these things, you know, these are all good in books. But I mind you, you have to have only one method, that is a stricter way of doing it. You can't, you know, go and start teaching these boys who are, you know, picking up arms on the name of jihad. And you'll say that you'll do it. See, mind you, nowhere in the world you fight the battle at your own town, on your own turf. When the thing perpetrators are sitting across, the jihad, United Jihad Council is in Pakistan. What we have done it?
Yes.
You'll say that we will list the war. Why we have not launched an operation which we are capable of doing it, but yes, we don't believe ourselves.
Just a short while back, no
multi-pronged attack on it.
Just a short while back, my colleague Kamaljeet Kaur Sandhu, she spoke to the Director General of the Central Reserve Police Force. Preliminary information was coming in at that point of time. Before that, I had spoken to the Director General of Jammu and Kashmir Police. We'll get you those details. Let's listen in to R.R. Bhatnagar. I'll also get you Dilbagh Singh's interview.
We are still assessing the cause of the blast. Main damage has been caused by the blast. There was some firing also, but that has not caused much damage. And we are still ascertaining the cause of the blast and the method of the blast.
Sir, do tell us the number of dead and the number of injured.
There are a few people injured. They are being taken care of. They have already been moved from there. But the number of casualties we would be able to only ascertain after some time.
Sir, you do tell me, please. Top senior officers have been rushed to the spot. We believe you are in Kum at this point of time. Will you also be going to Srinagar and to...
Yes, I'll be going there. Right now, my IG is already there. And senior officers are already on the spot.
But sir, do you think this has been a violation of SOP? Why has this taken place? Because this is a huge setback for any single day to lose so many people and to obviously have so many casualties.
So we are still ascertaining the cause of the blast, and it is too premature to comment on that.
Sir, thank you so much for speaking to us.
And just a short while back, I'd spoken to the Director General of Jammu and Kashmir Police, Dilbagh Singh. Let's listen in.
Yeah, it was an ID blast which has taken place near Lethpura in Pulwama on the highway.
Sir.
CRPF convoy was on way from Jammu to Srinagar, and that is the convoy which was targeted by the militants. Jaish-e-Mohammed has owned the responsibility of this incident, and it appears to be something like a car blast. There was a civilian car which was trying to cross over, and when it came near to CRPF convoy, as said, the initial report, that car blasted, and along with the car, the vehicle of CRPF also got the blasted factor. Around 30-40 people were traveling in this vehicle, and there are around 10 casualties, fatal casualties, as the reports that we got now, and some of them are injured, and they've been evacuated to the nearby hospitals. The police team headed by IG Kashmir and IG CRPF are on the spot. So they are taking an assessment of the situation and the blast. And they're also doing the evacuation part of our Indian people.
Sir, so this vehicle, this civilian vehicle was crossing the road and it hit a at the CRPF vehicle. Is that what you're saying, sir?
It looks like initial reports say there's very little to know about the existence of that vehicle has reportedly that vehicle has been blasted beyond identification. So therefore, it appears to be a, quite a big ID which was planted in a vehicle. That vehicle got blasted, and then along with that vehicle, this bus got the impact of the blast.
Sir, if I may, but, is this a fidayeen attack, which means the driver was there inside that vehicle? Is this a suicide attack, sir?
That could be possible. It looks like one.
So this was a fidayeen attack. We wouldn't know whether there was one person or more than one person inside this vehicle. Do we know the make of the vehicle?
Possible as of now, that vehicle is fully blasted, as per the reports. Rest we'll be able to see only when our investigation and all, they have close inspection of the site and all. But it looks like one. Okay, all right.
So that is the Director General of the Jammu and Kashmir Police telling India today that this is a suspected suicide attack. The bomber was inside that vehicle. It apparently was a Scorpio or a sports utility vehicle that went and hit the belly of this convoy, went and targeted a bus. We also have a reaction from General V.K. Singh, Minister of State for External Affairs, who said, as a soldier and as a citizen of India, my blood boils at the spineless and cowardly attacks. 18 brave hearts from the CRPF India at that point of time laid down their lives in Pulwama. I salute their selfless sacrifice. And this is where it's interesting. They're saying, okay, let's cut across and listen in to Minister of State in the Prime Minister's office, Jitendra Singh.
के निंदा करने में असफल रहते हैं आतंकियों की और आतंकवादी घटनाओं की और उल्टा भारतीय सेना और अर्धसेना बलों पर उंगली उठाते हैं शायद उनकी भी कहीं आंखें खुले और नहीं खुलती तो फिर ये देश को फैसला करना है कि जितना जितने देश के दुश्मन भारत के दुश्मन विदेशी ताकतें हैं जो इन आतंकियों को समर्थन दे रही हैं उतने ही या उससे बढ़कर के देश के भीतर बैठे हुए ऐसे राजनीतिक जो अपने आप को मुख्य धारा के राजनीतिक कहते हैं एक ओर से भारत सरकार के चुनावों में हिस्सा लेकर के छोटी मात्रा से वोट हासिल करके वो मंत्री पद ग्रहण करते हैं और दूसरी ओर पाकिस्तान और पाकिस्तान के द्वारा समर्थित आतंकियों के बारे में इस तरह के वक्तव्य देते हैं जिससे कि हौसले बुलंद होते हैं विदेशी ताकतों को मुझे लगता है कि पूरे विश्व में इस प्रकार का उदाहरण नहीं है और मैं ये आग्रह करूंगा कि जहां जैसे कि कहा गया कि आतंकियों के इस काम को बख्शा नहीं जाएगा दे विल नॉट बी स्पेयर्ड उसी तरह उनको भी ना बख्शा जाए जो इनके विषय में खुल के बात करने में या निंदा करने में अपने आप को असहाय महसूस करते हैं
We're also getting a reaction from the Congress Party General Secretary in charge of Eastern Uttar Pradesh, Priyanka Gandhi. Let's quickly listen in.
Pulwama में जो आतंकवादी हमला हुआ है, जिसमें हमारे जवान शहीद हुए हैं, इसकी वजह से हम ये अनुचित समझते हैं कि हम अभी राजनीतिक चर्चा करें। मैं आप सबसे आग्रह करूंगी और रामलाल राही जी से, अवतार सिंह भटाना जी से, जो हमारी पार्टी में आज शामिल होने के लिए यहाँ आए हैं आप सबसे आग्रह करूंगी कि दो मिनट की श्रद्धांजलि हम ऑब्जर्व करें शहीद जवानों के लिए और मैं उनके परिवारों को कहना चाहती हूं कि इस दुखद घड़ी में एक एक देशवासी आपके साथ है हम सबको बहुत दुख हुआ है आप हौसला बनाए रखें आपके साथ कंधे से कंधे मिलाकर हम खड़े हैं बहुत बहुत धन्यवाद
Okay, let's quickly cut across and listen in to the governor of Jammu and Kashmir, Satyapal Malik. Okay, we'll just get to the governor in a moment. But Brida Mahalingam, the point that General V.K. Singh as Minister of State for External Affairs was making when he says, I promise every drop of our soldiers' blood will be avenged. What does this mean?
See, the army has a very clear policy. When such incidents take place, we do not let that go and forget about it. Therefore, the government at that level must have now taken up the issue and they must be planning. We must also understand it will be at a time and place of our choosing. Such operations will have to be deliberate and it is going to take time. It can't be straight away done on a day. Second aspect which we also must understand It can't be one particular plan and we executed. No, it can't happen that way. There will be a number of options which will come up, at okay. which will be evaluated, and the risks will be involved, and the cost to enemy will be sort of calculated.
Absolutely. There must be costs on the inflicted on the enemy. My colleague Shweta Singh is speaking to the governor of Jammu and Kashmir, Satyapal Malik. Let's listen in.
सही सवाल आपने उठाया. पहली चीज तो यह है कि इतना बड़ा काफिला लेके नहीं चलना चाहिए. आप 2500 लोगों को लेके चल रहे हैं. इसके अलावा आपकी इस हाईवे पे स्पीड ज्यादा होगी तो इस तरह का हमला नहीं हो पाएगा. इसके अलावा जो चेकिंग में भी कहीं कोई चूक तो हुई है, सुरक्षा में चूक कई जगह हुई है, तभी ये पॉसिबल हुआ है, वरना ये संभव नहीं था. अगर हाईवे चेकिंग प्रॉपर होती तो विस्फोटक से भरी हुई गाड़ी इतने नज़दीक नहीं आ पाती. तो कहीं ना कहीं चूक हुई है, जिसमें हम सबको, सारी फोर्सेस को मिल बैठ के आपस में विचार करना होगा और जो चूक है, जो लूपहोल्स हैं, जहाँ कमियाँ हैं, उनको ख़त्म करना पड़ेगा.
आपने कहा वी विल हंट देम डाउन. पहले जब सर्जिकल स्ट्राइक की गई थी सरहद के उस पार किया गया था, इस बार पता है कि इधर भी करना है हमें. हम यहां पर यह समझें कि हमारे सुरक्षा बलों का मनोबल कहीं किसी तरीके से तो नहीं प्रभावित होगा.
सुरक्षा कर्मी बहुत कठिन परिस्थितियों में काम कर रहे हैं. मैं तो पहले दिन से हर जगह मैंने कहा कि आई स्टैंड बाय माय फोर्सेस, मैं अपने सुरक्षा बलों के बिल्कुल साथ हूं. लेकिन यहां के जो पॉलिटिकल लीडर्स हैं वो उनका मनोबल कमज़ोर करने की बराबर कोशिश करते हैं, उनके हर काम को क्रिटिसाइज करते हैं. और अभी तक आप देखिए कोई नहीं बोला इतना बड़ा हमला हुआ है, इतना अमानवीय हमला हुआ है, अभी तक किसी ने निंदा नहीं की है.
क्या सरहद के इस पार और उस पार दोनों तरफ कार्रवाई हो सकती है?
जहां जरूरी होगा होगा. हम उसमें इस जो घटना हुई है इसका बहुत ही स्पेसिफिक और बहुत मजबूत जवाब देंगे, और ऐसा देंगे ताकि आगे के लिए फोर्सेस डेटर करें इस तरह का काम करने के लिए.
अलगाववादी नेता बात बात पर पत्थरबाजों की बात उठा लेते हैं, उनके साथ खड़े हो जाते हैं, आतंकवादियों के साथ खड़े हो जाते हैं, कहां कहां नहीं नजर आती हैं ये सारी चीजें. अपनी आंखों के सामने अगर हम देखते हैं तो हमें जम्मू का वो वाकया भी याद आता है जब एक सीआरपीएफ के जवान ने कोशिश की थी कि गोली मार दी जाए उस इंट्रूडर को. बहुत सारे सवाल उठ गए थे. कैसे आज हमारे जवान ये समझें कि उनके साथ ये व्यवस्था खड़ी रहेगी अगर वो अपनी तरफ से कदम उठाएंगे, और अगर अपनी तरफ से कदम नहीं उठाएंगे तो फिर देखिए गिनती गिनते रह.
बिल्कुल तैयार है, हमें उनकी कोई परवाह नहीं है. वो पब्लिक में डिसक्रेडिटेड लोग हैं, लोग उनके साथ नहीं हैं, लोग ये जानते हैं कि ये हमें बर्बादी की तरफ ले जा रहे हैं, और हम उन नेताओं को कुछ नहीं मानते, उनकी बिल्कुल परवाह नहीं करते हैं. वो जो बोलें बोलते रहें, वो अपने कारणों से बोल रहे हैं, अपने फ्रस्ट्रेशन से बोल रहे हैं, वो जो ग्राउंड लूज कर गए इसलिए बोल रहे हैं, उससे हमारे किसी एक्शन पे कोई असर नहीं पड़ेगा.
एक बयान को लेके आपकी भी बहुत ज्यादा हंगामा मचा था, काफी विवादास्पद बयान था. किस तरीके से दिल को दर्द पहुंचता है अगर जो किसी एक कश्मीरी युवा को भी कोई चोट लग जाती है. इस तरह की चीजें जो कही गई थी उसे लेकर कटघरे में आप भी थे सर.
एक चीज बताऊं, मैं ये इतनी चीजें बता सकता हूं, मैं बोलता नहीं हूं, चूंकि फिर शोर मचाते हैं कि गवर्नर पॉलिटिकिंग कर रहे हैं. यहां एक अभी हम लोगों ने पंजाब के साथ समझौता किया है, कंडी में जो नदी है वो सारा पानी पाकिस्तान को जा रहा था. 40 साल से उस समझौते को इन लोगों ने नहीं होने दिया, और चूंकि वो पानी फिर जम्मू को मिलना था, अब वो पानी जम्मू के 40,000 हेक्टर से ज़्यादा सिंचाई करेगा. एक सिर्फ एक लाइन पे झगड़ा करते थे कि किसका कंट्रोल होगा. जब मुझे गडकरी जी ने बताया और अमरिंदर जी ने कहा तो मैंने कहा आप अपने मिनिस्टर को भेजिए. हमने 15 मिनट में MOU साइन किया और उस पर अब काम चालू होने वाला है. तो ये इन्होंने जो डेवलपमेंट के काम हैं, सड़कों के काम हैं, इसी तरह से डैम्स के काम हैं, बिजली के काम हैं, इन सबों को रोके रखा, और इन सबों की दिलचस्पी सिर्फ उन चीजों में होती थी जिसमें कुछ पैसा हो.
जी जिस तरह की बात हम कर रहे हैं, वाकई सर हमने देखा है कि भले ही सरकारें वहां पर बदलती गई हैं, मुख्यमंत्रियों के चेहरे बदले हैं, लेकिन श्रीनगर शहर की भी अगर हम बात कर लें, बादामी बाग कंटोनमेंट किस तरह का स्ट्रेटेजिक इलाका है, और वहां पर सामने गाड़ियों का काफिला लोगों का लगा रहता है. सिविलियंस की अगर जांच कर ली जाती है तो बाहर निकलकर गाली गलौज तक की नौबत आती है. मुझे तो ऐसा एक मुख्यमंत्री नहीं दिखा वहां पर जिसने पत्थरबाजों के पक्ष में न खड़े होकर राजनीति न करके वहां पर फ्लाईओवर बनाए हो. वहां पर अभी भी वहां पर गड्ढे हैं. जो बात आप कह रहे हैं वो बिल्कुल सही उस चीज पर हो जाती है, लेकिन इसके बावजूद वो बयानबाजी तो आ जाती है ना, जिससे कहीं ना कहीं इस पूरे देश का जनमानस के साथ साथ वो सुरक्षा कर्मी भी आहत होते हैं.
मैं ये इतनी चीज़ें बता सकता हूं, मैं बोलता नहीं हूं चूँकि फिर शोर मचाते हैं कि गवर्नर पॉलिटिकिंग कर रहे हैं। यहाँ एक अभी हम लोगों ने पंजाब के साथ समझौता किया है, कंडी, कंडी में जो नदी है वो सारा पानी पाकिस्तान को जा रहा था, 40 साल से उस समझौते को इन लोगों ने नहीं होने दिया, और चूँकि वो पानी फिर जम्मू को मिलना था, अब वो पानी जम्मू के 40,000 हेक्टर से ज़्यादा सिंचाई करेगा। एक सिर्फ एक लाइन पे झगड़ा करते थे कि किसका कंट्रोल होगा। जब मुझे गडकरी जी ने बताया और अमरिंदर जी ने कहा तो मैंने कहा आप अपने मिनिस्टर को भेजिए, हमने 15 मिनट में एमओयू साइन किया और उस पर अब काम चालू होने वाला है।
बहुत धन्यवाद सत्यपाल मलिक जी हमसे बातचीत करने के लिए, बहुत धन्यवाद आपका।
So that was Satyapal Malik talking about action that needs to be taken. I quickly want to once again cut across to India. Today's Ashraf Wani joining us live from Srinagar. Ashraf, have the CRPF vehicles now left for their camp? Any success in any information about Adil Ahmed Dar, the suspected suicide bomber? What was his background? When did he join Jaish-e-Mohammed terrorist organization? How was he radicalized? What more do we know?
Gaurav, basically the convoy which was put on the hold near the blast site that has been allowed to move to the respective places, and those vehicles had all reached here in Srinagar and are now moving to their battalion headquarters. As far as the operations are concerned, there was a massive search and combing operation which was initiated after this attack near the blast site and surrounding areas that is currently going on. But there is also another obstacle which always we see after the encounters. There are currently clashes going on in Kakpora in the favor of killed Jaish militant Adil Ahmed Dar, because he hails from the Kakpora area, which is very near to the Jammu Srinagar National Highway, and in fact to the place where this blast took place, a suicide attack took place. And now there are clashes currently going on between the security forces and the youths. That is another problem which the security forces have to deal here in countering the anti-militancy operations. As far as Adil is concerned, it is not a first one who has carried out the suicide attack here in the Kashmir Valley. Earlier we have seen another boy from the Thral town in 2017 carried out the Fidayin attack on a CRPF headquarters, that are the recruitmental headquarters in fact in the Avantipora itself. Now after that there were so many precautionary measures taken and the security was taken up for the security camps of particularly of the CRPF camps in the Kashmir Valley, and they were made the foolproof for such kind of attacks. But in this particular attack there was a strategy which was adopted differently by the Jaish militants, and also the first time this kind of attack has been witnessed here in the Kashmir Valley.
In fact, there was a suicide attack that had taken place at the gates of the Badamibagh cantonment. You'd recall you and I had covered that terrorist attack, but that time the Kashmiri leadership, the religious leadership, the political leadership, they'd spoken up against suicide terror attacks. Is radicalization now a big, big issue in the valley? Are counter-radicalization efforts happening and are they working, Ashraf?
Gaurav, basically this is the problem which the society in the whole, as well as the political leaders who are here in the Kashmir Valley, maybe the mainstream or the separatists, are facing, that the youths are completely going against the thinkings and we can say the preaches of the people or the religious leaders. We are seeing this new breed of militancy in the Kashmir Valley, where local youths are getting to pick the arms here in the Kashmir Valley, started particularly after the killing of the Burhan Wani. When Burhan Wani was killed, we have seen the spike in the local recruitments, and now since 2017 we are seeing now the local youths are getting radicalized to such an extent that they are ready to carry out these kind of suicide attacks in the Kashmir Valley, and probably that is the worrying for the security agencies as well as for the politicians and for the society here in the Kashmir Valley.
This is a massive terror attack. This is a terror attack which several are seeing as an act of war. Pakistan-based terrorist organization Jaish-e-Mohammed has taken responsibility for this terrorist attack, in which we are now being told 30 CRPF personnel have unfortunately lost their lives. There are several who are still critical. This was a sports utility vehicle that came and crashed into a CRPF convoy. This convoy was moving from Jammu to Srinagar. Now, there are several aspects here. Where was this Adil Ahmed Dar radicalized? Who are the elements who radicalized him? So, Ashraf, are the police agencies and the intelligence agencies now trying to get to Kakpora to get to know more? Is that why clashes are taking place even as we speak?
Absolutely, Gaurav. Basically, this may take time because these kind of investigations mainly take time, and after a long time, then the whole thing come out, how he was inducted into the Jaish-e-Mohammed when he got prepared. But the changing trend, what we have seen in the Kashmir Valley for last 2 years, is that if there is a bunch of youth anywhere in the city, you can't identify who is radicalized and who is not radicalized, who is the sympathizer of the militants and who is not. So this is a completely changing scenario here in the Kashmir Valley, which is the challenge for the security agencies. When they just on the suspicious things, they could not investigate a person because there is hue and cry in the area, in the civilian areas, as well as the political leadership comes in the support of those youths if they are picked up. But basically, there has to be seen the main reason, that what is the problem where these youths get radicalized, because it is not the youths, common youths in the Kashmir Valley, but we have seen in the recent times the highly educated, even in the job, youths in the Kashmir Valley have joined the militant ranks and have even picked the gun. You may be remembering the professor of the Kashmir University who just was killed within the 24 hours. Just
and that's the tragedy.
Hours,
that's no the tragedy. This massive radicalization that is taking place in the valley, and the leadership in the valley, is it doing anything to counter this radicalization that is happening? That's point one. And point two, I also want to understand when Union Minister Arun Jaitley says, we pray for speedy recovery of the injured, and then he goes on to say, terrorists will be given an unforgettable lesson for the heinous act. What does this unforgettable lesson mean? Because Ashraf, 250 terrorists, more than 250 terrorists were killed in the valley last year. 19 terrorist commanders were killed, but recruitment of terrorists, is it down or does it remain the same, Ashraf?
That is the point where the government is completely miscalculating the Kashmir problem. Basically, they think that probably by killing the local militants, they are going to end the militants in the Kashmir Valley. But that is not visible on the ground. We have seen when there is any local militant killed in any area, there is already another youth to replace him. And that is going on for last 2 years. We have seen the biggest encounter in the Kashmir Valley in Kulgam district last year in March, in which in a single day 12 militants were killed in a twin operation in the Kulgam district. But what is the reality, Gaurav? In the same month of March in the Kulgam district, 13 youths picked up the gun. There is a kind of a emotional attachment. What? Because the local militants have their friends, okay, have their sympathizers. And one of the interesting point, what I would say today about the Adil, is that what the local sources are telling us, that just 2 days back in Ratnipura, a militant of Hizbul commander,
yes,
was killed, and Adil was very close friend of that Hizbul commander who was killed in Ratnipura just 2 days back.
Interesting. Stay with me, Ashraf. We'll also have other reporters joining us from Ground Zero. Let me tell our viewers a little more about this terror attack. This is the Jammu-Srinagar National Highway 1 Alpha. Okay, so what happened? This was a convoy of CRPF vehicles. Of course, the number now CRPF tells us is more than 70. 70 vehicles were traveling from Jammu to Srinagar, carrying more than 2,500 CRPF personnel. So there were buses, there were trucks carrying equipment. Of course, there were also jeeps with officers and men. Now, when this place came near the Lethpura area in Avantipora, this is considered a Jaish-e-Mohammed stronghold. This is the national highway, Jammu-Srinagar National Highway, Avantipora. Avantipur. So just when they were reaching Avantipur, this vehicle seemed to have joined this entire convoy. It came close to a bus and then hit that bus. This is what preliminary information is. In this terror attack, we are unfortunately now telling our viewers that 30 brave CRPF personnel lost their lives. What we're also being told is that suspected suicide bomber Adil Ahmed Dar was also killed. Such was the intensity of the blast that that vehicle, the sports utility vehicle, was completely destroyed. Unfortunately, so was one of the buses. But fortunately, the vehicles were maintaining a distance, and that is why the amount of explosives that were laid in this vehicle, it didn't cause more damage than it did. Now, Jaish-e-Mohammed is a Pakistan-based terrorist organization. Remember when IC-814 was hijacked? That's the time a terrorist, Maulana Masood Azhar, who was languishing in a jail in Jammu and Kashmir, he was released in Kandahar. He went to Pakistan, and this terrorist then formed the Jaish-e-Mohammed terrorist organization. The first move, December 13, 2001, attack on the Indian Parliament. This is where Jaish-e-Mohammed, this was a joint operation of Jaish-e-Mohammed and Lashkar-e-Taiba. Then, October 1, 2001, an attack on the Jammu and Kashmir Assembly, again car bombing in which 38 people lost their lives. And remember, so there was an attack on the Parliament, there was an attack on the Jammu and Kashmir State Assembly, September 8, 2016, that terror attack in Uri, after which there was a surgical strike. They used incendiaries. These terrorists used incendiaries in that Uri terror attack. 19 soldiers had lost their lives. January 2, 2016, Pathankot Air Base, 8 people were killed. And remember, this was after Prime Minister Narendra Modi had extended this hand of friendship once again to Pakistan. He'd visited Pakistan, and then Pakistan-based terrorist organizations attacked the Pathankot Air Base. Now, one thing is very clear. Jaish-e-Mohammed is repeatedly involved in terror attacks. What should government of India be doing at this point of time? Remember, everyone talks about that Wuhan spirit, that friendship between India and China. And China is that country that is blocking action against Maulana Masood Azhar at the United Nations Security Council. So the question remains, will India be able to prevail on China, at least now? Take that Wuhan spirit forward and ensure action is taken against Maulana Masood Azhar. And news just coming in, a team of the National Investigation Agency will be on its way to Srinagar. This is now an NIA investigation. A 12-member team is being prepared. This team will be headed by an Inspector General Police, and this entire team will be leaving for Srinagar on board a special aircraft tomorrow morning. This is a 12-member NIA team. Any terror attack is investigated by the National Investigation Agency. What we're also being told is that a team of the National Bomb Data Center will be in Srinagar. The National Bomb Data Center will be taking samples from this terror site. They will have an idea about what kind of explosives were used for this intensity, for this terror attack. Ashraf Wani with me on the story. Ashraf, so Jammu and Kashmir police have been carrying out an investigation so far. They've reached Kakapora. They haven't been able to enter it because of stone pelting. But an NIA team also on its way. What more can you tell us?
Absolutely, Gaurav. We have seen when the Uri attack took place, then it was investigated thoroughly by the NIA, and the clues were found about all the links about that attack. And also in this case, now the NIA team is arriving Srinagar, and they are going to be on support, and they will investigate this whole attack and its links with the other agencies and other things. But so far, as far as NIA is concerned, we have seen the NIA is the agency in which most of the officers are who have already served in the Kashmir Valley and have experience about these kinds of attacks, and they are almost all senior officers who are in that team, and they are arriving tomorrow to the Srinagar, and they will go to minute details of this attack, and then probably will come up with their investigation.
Stay with me for a moment. I also have Ankit Tyagi joining me now for more on the story. And Ankit, the death toll, we are now told, unfortunately, has risen to 39. Tell us more. So was one bus targeted, or is it now emerging that there were other vehicles that also were targeted? And are these all blast injuries? Are there also gunshot injuries? What more do we know? Ashraf, death toll rises to 39. Are these all gunshot injuries, or are these are these blast injuries or gunshot injuries also?
Both, Goro. Basically, the impact of the explosive in the SUV was so much that it was heard almost all for 2 kilometers to 3 kilometers. Its sound was heard by the people. And also, we have seen in all these cases when the high intensity or we can say improvised explosive devices are used, they have a very dangerous impact on the bodies, on the human bodies. And probably the RDX may have been used in this explosive, in this IED, which exploded with the big bang on the Jammu Srinagar highway in this attack. And its impact is very dangerous. We have seen earlier also that how it is destroying everything which comes in its way. So probably in this attack also the people who were injured were critically injured, and they are unfortunately succumbing to the injuries. And despite all the attempts being taken by the army doctors, by the civilian doctors here in the 92 base hospital in Srinagar, but so far we are seeing that the casualties number is mounting, and now it is clearly the biggest and deadly attack so far in the history of 30 years of unrest and militancy in the Kashmir Valley.
And what action do the security forces intend to take? This is a big challenge. There's a new co-commander in Kashmir. A big, big challenge for him because terror has hit and hit hard. Ankit Tyagi with me on this story. Ankit, death toll rises to 39. This clearly, Ankit, is an act of war against India.
Absolutely. Nothing, you know, it's no longer a terror attack. This is an act of war. 39 soldiers have been martyred, Gaurav, and this night just keeps getting worse. What we are being told by our sources is that there could be more casualties because the bus in which the SUV had in fact rammed into, that has completely been destroyed. About 40 to 45 personnel were in that bus, and there has been certain injuries on two other vehicles at this point of time as well. Whether those are serious injuries or not, we'll have to wait for the official confirmation, but at least on the bus where the SUV rammed, that bus has completely been destroyed. Now this, since 2001, becomes the biggest terror attack in the state of Jammu and Kashmir. 38 soldiers had been martyred in the 2001 attack in the state. Now 39 is the death toll already. Pressure intense on the government to respond. The all options possibly, Gaurav, and you would know better, would be on the table. The NSA already in a huddle, and so is the entire government machinery. Tomorrow, Home Minister is to go to, in fact, Srinagar. At this point of time, what we have been told that not only a team of the NIA, there is also a team of the NSG bomb disposal squad experts, which is also likely to visit Jammu and Kashmir to identify the exact nature of the explosive which has been used in this big terror attack, Gaurav.
Ankit, for the moment, many thanks for joining me. Ankit, Ashraf, our entire team of reporters will continue to track developments on the story very, very closely. The worst terror attack in Jammu and Kashmir after Uri, one of the worst ever in the state. 39 CRPF personnel have lost their lives. Remember, we were told that there were 39 CRPF personnel in this vehicle that was targeted, in this bus that was targeted.
Thanks for watching the video. For more such news and updates, please like, share and subscribe to India Today. Also, check out our other great videos from our channel. We know you will love to.